Whoa, hold on. You want to hear this.
Don't skip.
All right, so we are giving away free stuff.
Free stuff!
What you need to do is pay attention at the end of the show after game two, and we're going to tell you how you can win and what you can win.
Yep, and you guys are about to watch a brand new episode of Game Nights, which is only made possible thanks to the generous contributions of our patrons. Check out patreon.com/commandzone if you like this content, want to see more of it, and support the show. Thank you all so much.
All right, on to the games.
What's up, guys? Welcome to Game Nights, Episode 4, Monocolor Edition. I'm Jimmy. I'm one of the hosts of the Command Zone. I'm very excited to be joined with some new friends today.
My name is Wesley Ruttle. My friends call me Wes, and I'm a game designer at Riot Games.
Hi, everyone. It's Vinny. They brought me back, even though I helped everyone win last time.
This time we're playing the mono-colored legendaries from Aether Revolt. Super exciting.
Before we get started, we have a little surprise for everyone. Okay, guys, because you are our honored guests, and we are all playing mono-colored decks, we wanted to give you guys your matching playmats! There's Yahenni, here's Sram.
Wait.
Yeah.
Welcome to Game Nights. Only one may stand.
Right, that's kind of determined to say that every time. I don't know why.
Only one.
Sweet. Woo. Today, I am playing Sram. He is a Voltron commander. When we say Voltron, we're talking about making one creature out of a whole bunch of parts. So usually piling a bunch of auras and equipment on a single commander to make something that is really huge and just defeats them in one swing.
I got assigned mono green again. I'm playing Rishkar. So the way that I decided to build the deck is to use the mana that Rishkar helps you create to put more +1/+1 counters on the creatures, and then eventually you don't tap them for mana anymore. You start attacking with them because they're really big.
Of course, I absolutely had to play the mono red deck, and I wanted to play one of the greatest legendary creatures ever printed, Roggevon. To play Roggevon, I have to play this other called Kari Zev, Skyship Raider. She has first strike and menace, and every time she swings in and attacks, Roggevon swoops in from the top of her skyship, jumps down on her shoulder, and also comes in attacking as a 2-1 that gets exiled at the end of combat.
Jimmy, can you do your awesome monkey sound for us?
Yeah. That's what Roggevon sounds like.
Your monkey sound is way too good.
I've been practicing it for a long time. All right.
Yep.
Practice.
Forgive it's not perfect.
All right. Today I'm playing Yahenni. That's way too rehearsed. Yahenni's big deal is having everybody's creatures die to make sure that no one has any creatures on the board and Yahenni's growing as big as possible.
Wes is a game designer, and so he's really well-versed in the nuances of not just Magic, but all games.
Wes is probably one of the most skilled overall gamers that I know.
So I'm really scared that I try to do something, and in response, he's gonna do something to me. Like, come on, don't ruin my plans, Wes. So Josh is playing Rishkar.
I don't know exactly what to expect from it because there are a lot of different strategies you could take with that.
So it's gonna be really interesting to see how he built this deck, if he can ramp out some huge creatures really early.
I'm kind of excited to see how he brews it.
Jimmy's playing, of course, the mono red deck, which is scary because if anybody in our playgroup knows a color, it's Jimmy and red.
Red is everything that Jimmy wants in life and Magic. I expect him to be attacking every single turn and putting monkeys into play.
Vinny is playing the Yahenni deck.
I'm really worried about this one. It's a mono black deck that's focused around sacrificing.
I don't have that many creatures out on the board, so if things get sacrificed and I have to sacrifice creatures, it's gonna really set me back.
So I'm gonna probably have a lot of trouble dealing with the Yahenni deck.
Hold on, Josh.
Yeah.
I noticed you have a Sriracha t-shirt. You also have Sriracha sleeves. And you have a freaking Sriracha notebook.
That's what I'm talking about.
You're playing mono green.
Yeah. But my deck's spicy.
Oh my gosh. You've never been this on theme before in your entire life.
They're green on the inside. Green on the inside.
All right. I guess this is acceptable.
The sleeves are the awesomest.
I mean, they are pretty great. It is also my favorite hot sauce, so.
It's the best. I can like drink it straight. So. Don't try that at home, kids.
All right, guys, it is time to roll off first.
Oh, look at these fancy dice.
I just got this box. I'm really excited about it. You can really roll like a champ.
That's the worst. Come on, Vinny.
All right. I will choose to go first.
Surprise.
I will play a snow-covered mountain and pass the turn.
I'll play a plains and then a Thraven Inspector.
Ooh.
Oh, make a clue.
I have a lot of like Metalcraft synergies and Artifact Matters synergies. So 1-2 for one that brings in a clue that worst comes to worst, I just sack it to draw a card. That guy's perfect for my deck.
Swamp.
Forest. I'll make a 1-1 endless one. Oh my gosh, that's savage.
Oh,
yeah. So Endless One is a great turn one play in this deck because it will tap for mana once Rishkar comes out. Or if you draw it later, you could play it for 10 mana and then it's just a 10-10. So it's very versatile.
Let's go ahead and play Scrying Sheets. That's why I have my stuff.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I need any mana card advantage. Kari Zev, Skyship Raider, has entered the battlefield.
So quick.
Monkeys are coming in.
I'm going to play Sram.
Senior Artificer.
There's two commanders out already.
Yeah. And then I will play Hathor's Shield.
I'll draw.
It begins.
It's turn two, and I have already played three cards, and I have four permanents and two lands out on the field.
How are you feeling at that point?
At that point, I'm feeling great. This is an ideal opening. It feels fantastic.
And I will attack you, Vinny, for one.
I don't like this. I'm gonna remember this.
This was a strange game because Wes had also played a one drop. And then Jimmy had a two drop commander. Wes had a two drop commander. So there was just a ton of board presence very early on.
Swamp, go ahead.
Nothing?
Yeah.
Dude, everybody else has played so.
I know.
Wes has played 17 things.
Wes has four cards on his battlefield. I have one.
I'm going to tap two and play Metallic Mimic, naming Elf.
Okay.
You just name Elf, which is your primary type that Rishkar is. And Rishkar is going to enter with a 1-1 counter. And there's a whole bunch of other elf creatures in the deck.
And then Vinny, I attack you for one.
So because I was only playing Swamp, everybody pretty much attacked me.
All right, go to combat. Josh, I'll hit you for one, and then Vinny, I'll hit you for a Ragavan two. Ooh,
Bam!
Oh, the monkey.
Everyone's like, oh, anybody have any blockers? Vinny doesn't have blockers? Oh, let's attack Vinny.
And then I'll play Sword of Feast and Famine.
Whoa.
Oh, pass turn. I don't get to draw a card off it, though. Guys, come on.
Things are progressing. Oh,
this is probably the most important thing I can do at this point because it's protection from black and green, so I can essentially swing at Josh or Vinny anytime.
I'll play a Conviction on Sram.
Combo.
It's happening.
I'll draw. Over the long haul, Conviction is one of the best cards that my deck can draw because by bouncing it for one mana and then replaying it for two, I can effectively just pay three mana to draw a card, which is really a good engine to have online. Vinny, I'm gonna attack.
What is going on here?
Three. I'm sorry, Vinny. I'll stop attacking you soon.
Yeah, as soon as you play,
you know, when you're dead. I'll stop attacking you. Vinny got off to a slower start. He just sort of went land. And as a result, we were just bashing him.
Wes attacked me first, then Josh, then Jimmy, then Wes again.
Not that anybody's keeping track.
I mean, I play Temple Bell. Stop attacking me.
Temple Bell. So we're supposed to stop attacking you because you're going to make us draw cards?
Yes, I will definitely.
So if we attack you, we just don't draw cards?
Yep, you won't draw cards.
I don't think Wes cares about drawing cards at all. He draws a card every time he plays a card.
That's true.
One of my primary things is I need to find a way to dissuade Jimmy from attacking me with that Sword of Feast and Famine, because I do not want to discard the card.
I'll pay three playing Rishkar.
So Rishkar will get a counter from the Metallic Mimic, and then he'll give a counter back to the Mimic and the Endless One.
Yeah, that's very good, it seems.
So now I have two colorless creatures that can get around the protection from green from the sword and double block and potentially take out Kari Zev.
Okay, I want to be able to block, so go ahead.
Okay, well, I'm going to equip the sword. Vinny, I'm gonna swing at you, and then the monkey is just gonna come at you, Josh. So you can block for free.
Yep, I block with Rishkar.
How much am I taking?
Three.
The damage isn't that bad, but
his Sword of Feast and Famine
is making me discard a card.
Okay, because Sword of Feast and Famine hits, I will untap all of my lands. I've missed my fourth land drop, which is a sad time to be alive.
Ooh, that is unfortunate.
Instead, I will play a Mimic Vat.
Peace.
And I'll pass turn.
All right, Vinny, I'll make a deal with you. If you activate your Temple Bell now, I will not attack you.
Now?
Yes, I want the card for my turn.
Sure.
Cool.
Everybody
wow.
I should have done that last time.
I like that negotiation.
Sure.
Because I also got a card.
And then I will play Mask of Memory.
Ooh, nice.
Okay.
That's in my deck too.
Draw a card.
Yeah. Yep.
Off of Sram. Equip Mask of Memory onto Sram. Jimmy, I'm attacking you at Sram.
Sure.
I'll draw two cards from Mask of Memory.
And then Wes is drawing about 50 cards.
Discard a plains.
Yeah. What is happening?
How many cards do you have, Wes?
I have 8 cards. That's unfortunate.
Mono white.
Mono white.
This Sram is bad,
sweet.
Actually.
Yeah,
this
Sram is, this
Sram is sweet.
Sweet. Yeah. I just need a blocker. I'm just going to play a cockroach. Endless cockroaches. It's a card that pretty much when it dies, it comes back to my hand. So it could be a blocker for every now and then.
Pass okay. the turn.
All right.
So when Jimmy misses his land drop, we all notice.
Jimmy, I'm going to play this card as a warning to you that if you do anything to me.
I didn't do anything to you last turn.
I know. Just more. I'm just putting that out there.
Oh, strip mine. Oh, gosh.
Because when you're cramped on lands already, the last thing you want to be happening is somebody starts blowing up your lands.
If you use that strip mine on me, it will be, I will literally spend the rest of game nights going straight at you.
I know, but you'll have 2 mana, so. I'm just saying, I'm giving you the warning. Just don't come at me.
Where did this aggression come from? I haven't even, it's not even my turn. I haven't even entered combat yet. We're not at the point where everyone's like, wait, who are you attacking with that creature?
I figure that's a good way to deter any sort of aggression from sort of feast or famine.
But it actually worked because I didn't really have incentive to attack Josh.
I play Scrounging Bandar. It's 2 counters.
Ooh, that guy's so good in that deck.
Play lands.
He drew more lands.
Ooh, that's not good. I'll play Thran Dynamo. 4. I'm going to combat.
Oh, no.
Kari Zev will swing at you, Vinny, for 3, right. And then Ragavan. We'll come at Wes for 2.
Take the 2.
Take 3.
I will untap all of my lands. Untap 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and play Warstorm Surge.
Oh!
Make things go crazy.
It's decent with Ragavan. It's
and
okay.
Then I will pass that turn. I'm feeling great. I have so much mana. I have Scour from Existence in my hand. I can get rid of any permanent on the board. I have Ward of Seizing in my hand so I can steal a creature or a permanent at instant speed that has split second. I have a lot of answers and I'm basically just set.
I'm going to play Sky Sovereign, console flag.
Talk about that.
Wow.
And, all right.
When it comes into play, I will have it deal 3 damage to... It looked like Josh's board was the one that was getting the most developed. I think we're going to take out the Mimic. Felt like a really good idea, and I was pretty sure this was going to work out great, but then...
Okay, hang on. In response to the Skyship target, I play Inspiring Call. So my guy's got indestructible, and I'll draw 1, 2, 3, 4 cards.
Okay, cool.
Oh my god.
That seems insane.
That card really overperformed.
After that, I still feel like I'm in good position on the board. I was hoping that I would take Josh down a peg with it, but I'm on the back foot, so I leave my guys back to block, but I'm feeling good about how I'm set up, and I'm ready to start swinging with Sky Sovereign to actually start carving up all of my opponent's creatures.
I'm gonna read the bones.
I have all these expensive cards in my hand, so I really needed to find mana ramp so I can start playing them. Because if I didn't, I was just gonna get run over.
Take 2?
Yep, take 2. Soul Ring.
Oh, all right.
Sword of the Animus.
Ooh, okay, all right.
All right, stuff happened.
He's having a good turn.
Pass the turn.
So I'm looking at the board, and Jimmy has a Thrawn Dynamo. He's got a Sword of Feast and Famine. He's got a Mimic Vat. Wes has a whole ton of auras and vehicles and equipment, like a Sky Sovereign over there. And Vinny's basically only played one little creature and a whole bunch of artifacts. And I'm just going to destroy them.
Thing of Progress.
Ah.
So destroy all artifacts and enchantments.
And that is so bad for me.
Destroys the world, essentially.
It takes out like 12 things. And I have this huge thing sitting there after it's all done and the dust settles.
How in Craigslist? Josh. Josh!
Josh. Josh!
All right, let's go to combat.
Jimmy.
What, all of them?
Well, he can double block and kill.
He can just one block.
And it just goes back to his hand, so.
It felt like at that point the game was decided. I just looked at my hand, looked at the board and went, we're gonna lose to Josh in this game.
Then I will harden scales.
So I'm feeling really good at this moment. I've taken command of the game. I've set them back to the Stone Age. It feels like if I can just put my foot on the gas, I can, you know, close this game out in short order.
This is bad.
It is bad. It's pretty bad.
Well, I have a Ward of Seizing. So if Josh attacks me with the Bane of Progress, maybe I can steal it and block. So I leave mana up.
I'll pass turn.
Okay. I'll untap. My next turn, though, really illustrated why I love Sram as a commander. Then I will play Trusty Machete. Draw a card.
Yeah. Yep.
Off of Sram. Despite losing so much stuff, I'm already ready to rebound. Play a Smuggler's Copter.
Nice.
Ooh.
Draw a card.
Wes's deck is sweet. Every single card he plays, he draws a card. So he's like, play this, draw a card. Play this, draw a card. Play that, draw a card.
Then I'm going to play Etched Champion.
Metalcraft is online, right?
Yeah. Metalcraft is online.
Pretty good.
Yeah, go ahead.
No one has Wrath of God? Right. Any kind of wrath?
Not at the moment.
I'm digging.
I'll cast Underworld Connections on this one.
Okay.
So I really needed a board wipe to destroy all creatures, especially Josh's creatures. And drawing two cards a turn gave me a faster chance of finding it.
Oh, pass the turn.
Go to combat.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Yep.
Jimmy, Vinny.
I'll take three.
So I'll block.
Then I will send a card resurgent.
I played a good card, but it didn't feel like it was doing what I need to be doing at that time. That card doesn't do a good job of adding to the amount of damage I can do.
In the next turn, I'm like, all right, I can't not do anything.
All right, I'll play Impact Tremors. It's not doing anything right now.
You could say its impact is minimal.
It is certainly minimal. And then I'll play Price of Glory. So what I'm saying is no more instant shenanigans, no more instant speed removal. It doesn't affect Josh that much because he can tap his creatures for mana, which is really sucky because he's in the most commanding position.
Okay, I'm going to start off with Thraben Inspector, crewing Smuggler's Copter, okay. And then declaring attacks at you, Josh.
Is this standard?
Take three.
So I have my strip mine, and Wes goes to play an aura on one of his lands.
I'm going
to
play Genju of the Fields on this plains. I draw a card.
And I have the ability to strip mine it at that moment so that it would fizzle the spell. But I don't want to use a strip mine for that because you do that and then somebody plays like a Glacial Chasm or a Dark Depths or something really bad. And you're just like, why did I waste that strip mine? So I hold it.
So I'm going to cast Angelic Purge as an additional cost. I'm going to sacrifice the planes that Genju of the Fields is on, returning it to my hand and exiling Zendikar Resurgent.
And so now we can play the aura again, draw another card off Sram.
Genju on here, draw a card.
Okay, hang on.
Now that you have done two things to me.
I just don't like setting the precedent that you can do things to me and I don't retaliate. So I'm like, nope, I got to strip mine the land this time. I don't care if somebody plays a Dark Depths later or whatever. I just don't want to be giving you free passes on doing stuff to me.
I'm going
to
float the mana and play Stoneforge Mystic.
Ooh.
Oh, that's scary.
Okay.
That's all cool. Right.
Yeah. That's cool.
I am going to grab my Sword of Feast and Famine.
Ooh.
Go ahead, Vinny.
Cockroaches are back.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. Grafted Exoskeleton.
Oh! Ooh,
that card's sweet.
Grafted Exoskeleton is slightly worrying, actually, because Yahenni has haste. So you always have to start making calculations whenever you do stuff now of can he play Yahenni, equip the Grafted Exoskeleton, and somehow get it up to 10 infect damage on me. So it's just always in the back of your mind.
Pass the turn.
Who to kill?
No one.
No one.
I mean, even though it's an instant kill, you should probably kill the person that's not going to kill you.
Kill no one.
As much as I don't want you to kill me, I am the correct answer here.
It's definitely Triumph of the Horse.
Yeah, I'm playing Triumph of the Horse.
Jimmy, you and I are dead, I think.
Oh, God.
And I'm really debating what to do because my choice is I can either kill both Jimmy and Vinny.
I have one blocker. If he attacks me, I am dead.
He definitely is going to be able to kill at least one of us, maybe two.
Oh, boy.
Or I can kill Wes.
I kind of stupidly talked myself up as the right person to attack, but I do really think I was the right person for him to kill at that moment, so.
So, Jimmy and Wes.
Because of Price of Glory, I just tapped out on my own turn, and I'm just hitting myself in the head because I had Swords to Plowshares in my hand.
Go! I'm dead.
So Josh deletes Wes off the face of this planet.
That's rough. It's a rough way to go out, man.
I will block Endless One with Kari Zev.
Yep.
And then I will take 1, 2, 3, 4 infect.
Five
infect. So now basically my entire goal is just, you know what? I can't get beat. I'm going to hold all my mana up. I have Word of Seizing. I can destroy a permanent.
I'll pass turn.
All right. Baleful Force. Okay, I'm going to keep drawing.
You have every different Phyrexian arena humanly possible.
I was drawing on Josh's turn, Jamie's turn, and my own turn. So I was drawing 5 cards a turn. The only drawback was I was losing life as I was drawing cards.
All right, go to combat.
Okay.
Combat.
James.
I go to attack Jimmy.
Okay, you've declared its actors.
I have.
You've passed priority.
Correct.
Josh swings at me with his 14-14 Bane of Progress and a couple of creatures, and I'm like, I can do something. I'm going to cast Word of Seizing. I steal Josh's Bane of Progress. I'm like, I'm going to block Rishkar and kill him.
And Wes leans over and goes, Jimmy.
I don't know how to break this to you, Jimmy.
What? You have Price of Glory on the battlefield.
Oh, no! He totally forgot about his own card. I felt so bad for him at that moment.
And he has to sacrifice 5 lands.
I go from 7 mana all the way to 2.
So Rishkar dies, but Jimmy's just done at that point.
Man, I gotta be worried about that, though.
No.
Because if you just equip and swing and have one removal spell, I'm in a little bit of trouble. Yeah, I'm too scared of getting one-shotted by the Grafted Exoskeleton, so I'm gonna Cursing Grip it. Okay. I will play Mind's Eye and then pass the turn, Jimmy.
At this point, I'm feeling pretty good. I'm just worried about Vinny playing some kind of board wipe effect.
I will draw, lose another life.
I will pass turn.
Take one from my underworld connections.
I get one.
My upkeep, I will draw.
So this is getting worrisome because Vinny is A, the player most likely to have board wipes, and B, drawing five cards per rotation of the table. So if he's more likely to have a board wipe, well, drawing five cards is more likely to have him find one.
It's never good. The tippy tap.
Yeah.
It's never good.
He's counting it up. Mm-hmm. It seems like you're in trouble.
So I now have a plan.
So I'll tap Nykthos. I have seven black symbols out, so I'll have seven mana. I'm gonna spend four of it. So Diabolic Tutor, I'll find Cabal Coffers, and I'll play this as my land drop for turn. So I have three black floating. I will tap Cabal for one, two, three, four, five.
So you end up with six.
Yep, six. I have six, seven, eight, nine, 10. I'm gonna spend three of it to cast Yahenni. So I have seven mana left.
And this is just bad.
Vinny has this explosive turn. I mean, he just goes off.
With seven mana.
This is not good.
I'm gonna cast Necromantic Selection. I destroy all creatures in response to me casting the spell. I will sacrifice Endless Cockroaches to make Yahenni indestructible.
Okay.
Necromantic Selection resolves. So Yahenni gets three plus one counters. I'll bring Baleful Force back.
It was great, because now Josh has no board, Jimmy has no board. I can attack freely.
Combat.
Do it, Vinny.
And I'll attack you for five
damage. Oh my gosh, that was intense.
That was a good turn.
That was a really good turn.
At that point, I felt like I had gone from the lowest in the game to pretty much taking command of the game.
So the board wipe was bad, but I think I can recover from it. I have still a lot of cards in my hand.
So I'm gonna play Nissa, Voice of Zendikar.
Okay.
I'm gonna plus her to make a 0/1 plant.
Blockers.
And then I'm gonna play Rishkar.
Okay.
And then I'm gonna put a 1/1 counter on the plant and Rishkar, cool. Which will put two because Hardened Scales.
And I'm thinking like, if I can live one more turn, I actually have some cards in hand that can get me a board presence again and maybe I can stabilize here.
Jimmy, pass turn.
So I'm like, all right, maybe I'll draw some lands. I didn't draw lands.
I'll pass turn.
I'm gonna tap, Toll of False God, Cabal Coffers, make you five mana, spend the five mana, make Dictate of Erebos.
So now whenever I sack a creature, Josh also has to sacrifice a creature, which is great because I have my Endless Cockroaches.
So I'll tap to make 10 mana.
With Nykthos.
Yes, with Nykthos. I sack Endless Cockroaches to Yahenni because of Dictate of Erebos. Everybody has to sacrifice a creature.
I sack a plant token. What do you sack, Jimmy?
I'm gonna sack nothing.
Yeah, Endless Cockroaches goes back to my hand.
Yep.
I have 7 mana left.
Oh,
I spend 3 mana, cast Endless Cockroaches.
He can just play them and sack them, play them and sack them. And every time he does that, I have to sacrifice a creature.
Pretty much, Jimmy and Josh can never have a creature on the board again.
I use the last of my mana to cast Locks and Warhammer.
Well, you don't have any life equip problems anymore.
To Yahenni.
What is Yahenni now?
Yahenni is now
seven,
a 10-7.
Trample Lifelink.
Trample Lifelink. Combat, I will attack Josh with Yahenni and Nissa with Baleful Force.
That's a dead Nissa, and I take 10 more commander damage. So I go to 13, and I've taken 15 commander damage.
And I go up in 10 life.
Okay, I'll play Cauldron of Souls.
Cauldron of Souls, all right.
My one sort of way that I had to sort of last a little bit longer was Arachnogenesis in my hands. And I was planning on using that to survive one more turn to see if there was something I could do.
Draw a card.
Okay, draw a card too.
Pass turn. I feel like there's nothing I can do at this point.
Okay. Exsanguinate.
Oh.
So I'm like all ready to stop his combat damage from happening, and he plays a card that just basically sucks the life right out of me.
So everybody takes 15.
Dead.
That's what happened, basically.
Combat at Jimmy.
Oh, in response, I'm gonna tap both my mountains and sacrifice them. And I died.
Live fast, die young.
So, thank you for the good advice.
Yeah, you're welcome. Anytime, man. Don't mention it.
I expected something to blow up all of my things.
Yeah.
But specifically Bane of Progress having the 15-15 attached to it, or 14-14, however big it was, is arbitrarily large.
It's funny because normally a 14-14 a commander, you're just like, whatever.
But it was like turn five. So early.
Okay, tell me the truth. How long have you been holding it in your hand? Were you like, I'm going to let Josh kill somebody, and then I'll mess him up? Like,
I did not have it.
So it was right then. You were in a really good position.
I was going to crush you.
Yeah.
All right, you guys ready?
All right, game two. Here we go.
All right. Plans.
Calm down, sir.
Core Duelists.
Or duelist.
Wow. So the game started out super sweet. Again, I had a one drop. This time, probably a better one drop.
Swamp pass.
All right, I'm gonna forest animation module.
Whoa.
The game started out pretty good. I got one of the better turn one plays in the deck.
Snow-covered mountain pass.
Play out Sram.
Big surprise.
So turn two, I played Sram, as I imagine most games will go when I play this deck, and I went Sram into Cathar's Shield, and then off of the Cathar's Shield, I drew a Paradise Mantle. So I played 2 zero-cost equipments out on turn two, which means, once again, I have 4 permanents and have drawn 2 cards off of this deck's opening, which feels fantastic.
He's about to get Sram-wrapped.
Except. Swing at you, Josh, for one.
I didn't even win last game.
Go ahead. You have a thing. You have a thing.
Yeah, you have a thing.
What's the thing got to do with it?
Early game, same thing happened. Turn one, swamp. Turn two, swamp.
Swamp, go ahead. I played 10 protector, face up.
Whoa.
Which is not really what you want to do. You usually want to morph it and then flip it up and then get something out of your graveyard. But because Rishkar is going to come out on turn three, and I really want to distribute the 2/1/1 counters to 2 creatures to make 2 mana dorks, I just had to bite the bullet. Play the Den Protector then.
I will play Zari Kev. I will play Kari Zev, Skyship Raider.
I mean, Zari is a
Zari,
cool name.
Zari, yeah, Kev.
Zari Kev.
Cool.
And when you hit people,
Zari
you can be
Kev
like,
cool.
I'm Zari.
I'm Zari. I can say I'm Kari. Sorry about that.
I'm going to play a trusty Machete.
Machete?
Draw.
I wish I could draw so many cards.
Machete.
I'm just waiting for it. I will play Smuggler's Copter.
Oh my gosh. Every card replaces it.
This is even better than last time. And last time was good.
Tech Vinny with just Sram.
1/2. Commander damage. So once again, no early game plays means early game aggression towards me. Are you gonna attack me again?
Probably.
He's an honest man. You gotta give him that.
I don't wanna make an enemy out of you. You can attack me, that's fine for the next one. Tumble Bell.
Hey!
Tumble Bell, surprisingly, again. It's like I'm getting flashbacks.
So I'll pay 3, cast Rishkar.
I'm able to play Rishkar, put the 1/1 counters onto Rishkar and the Den Protector, and then, because a 1/1 counter went onto a creature, the animation module triggers, and now the Den Protector can tap for mana. So I use that mana to make a servo. So the value's already started.
And then, next turn.
I will tap 3 to play the Ronin War Club.
Oh, baby.
So I swing with Kari Zev. Bragavan comes out, the War Club immediately attaches to him and just makes him a much bigger beater. I go swing at you with 1 for Zari. And then Bragavan comes in. And then the Ronin War Club trigger attaches, and this will come at you, Vinny.
I will take 1.
Wow, that was a big monkey.
And then monkey goes, bye bye. And I'll pass turn.
And he says, Zori!
Zori! So that was really fun.
Okay, I'm gonna tap 3, Sword of Feast and Famine.
Oh, draw. God.
Okay.
I'll play a Kite Shield, draw a card.
Okay, yep. Alright, things are happening.
There are a lot of zero mana equipment.
There are, oh, yeah. Sweet. Leon and Bola, draw a card.
The thing about Wes's deck is every single turn it was playing like 4 or 5 things.
I will use Court Duelist to crew Smuggler's Copter, and I will attack you, Jimmy, sorry.
Unbelievable.
I'll take 3. Draw and then discard. Yeah, go ahead.
Rex Scenery! this story again, we know how this goes, guys.
Guy's Cradle?
Oh.
That's a good card. I ain't gonna lie. It's a good cat.
It might be the most powerful card in all of our decks combined.
Yeah, probably.
Other than Sram.
Tap Cradle and the Relic Rift for 1 and play Vidalcan Ori.
Hey, instant speed. I hear that's good.
So much of what a green deck's not able to do is it doesn't have a lot of obfuscation. And what Vidalcan Ori allows you to do is to play that stuff on the end step before your turn, and then it's much harder for your opponents to react to what's happening.
As a Vidalcan Ori, I can just pass turn.
I will play a very sad Temple of the False God.
Aww. Yeah, when it's your 4th land, it's not as good.
It's almost as though I didn't play a land. I'll play Magus of the Wheel.
Oh.
Oh.
Be likey.
So I was feeling pretty good about that. The fact that I had something like that to refill my hand at any point felt nice. And I'll pass turn.
Okay. Move to equip Sword of Feast and Famine onto my Court Duelist.
Yep.
Is that cool?
Yeah.
I mean, no, but yeah, it happened.
I'll tap 3 and equip Cathar's Shield to it as well.
Oh, it's huge.
Oh.
How big is it right now?
So now it is a 3/6 Vigilance.
Double strike.
Per black, per green. All right, I will attack Vinny with Core Duelist. The way Double Strike works is he'll deal damage during his first strike phase and the normal strike phase, which means Sword Feast and Famine triggers twice. Okay, so first strike damage.
Okay. One, two, three.
I'll untap my lands. You discard a card?
Yep.
I'm gonna...
Oh, man. Ooh, so you had to discard two cards?
He's hitting Vinny with double strike, untapping his lands twice. Vinny's discarding two cards. I mean, the whole thing's very scary.
Then second main phase, I'm going to tap three, play Sword of Light and Shadow.
Oh.
Draw a card.
He's got protection from your deck.
Yeah. This doesn't look good.
And then I will play Flare Husk and draw another card.
Oh yep. My goodness.
This is turn five?
Yeah, this is turn five.
What in the hell?
It just seems like if we're not careful, he's gonna run away with the game so fast here.
I'm like, there's no way I can lose this game unless someone pulls out some sort of big board wipe that also like really hits artifacts, because I'm pretty creature light at this point. I'm feeling great about my position.
All right, this is not good. Megas of the Coffers.
I'm hoping that, you know, it can bring me back into the game because it'll make a ton of mana for me next turn.
I'm going to activate Animation Module, which will add one counter to the Den Protector, which will trigger Animation Module, and then I'll tap the Den Protector for mana to make another Sherpa. It's a little lackluster, but...
You did not use the Orrery. But hey, now you're tapping for four mana with your Guy's Cradle. Like, yeah, whatever. Yeah.
Because I have a Vidalcan Orrery, I'm able to just draw my card and then pass the turn. I don't need to play anything. I can wait and respond to what's happening with what's needed.
But it's so like,
narrow. Vinny, can I draw a card? I need a land drop, otherwise we're all gonna die to this.
I know, but you're not gonna attack me, right?
Obviously. No.
Yeah, obviously. Not. All right, everybody draw.
Okay. Thank God. Play land. Temple of the False God is online. I'm gonna tap four, and I will play Nevin Rael's Disc. It's the best I can do.
Wes's board is scary, Josh's board is scary. This is great, because Jimmy's gonna do everything for me, and I can just sit back and reap the benefits.
I'm sort of two minds about it, because my Vidalcan Orrery's out, my board's not that weak. I thought about actually destroying it myself, but I figured I'd wait and see what Wes does, because I know Wes really needs to get rid of the Nev's Disc.
Oh man, this is like exactly my worst nightmare. Not only is it a board wipe that's gonna kill all my creatures off, but it's also going to kill all of my artifacts.
And then I will pass turn. It was looking like I might be able to actually gain some leeway and get a little, move a little bit forward on the advantage sort of tracker of the game.
Okay, I'm going to tap to equip Sword of Light and Shadow to my Voltron monster.
Okay.
Then I'm going to play Mask of Memory, drawing a card off Sram. So I equip my Mask of Memory onto my Double Striker to try to dig for answers. Okay, I am going to declare attacks.
Yes.
Yeah.
Smuggler's Copter is attacking you, Jimmy. Okay. And I need this to hit, so I guess I need to hit Vinny with this.
Whoa.
There's no way for me to get around his blockers, and I need to hit a creature.
He's gonna blow him up anyway.
Yeah. And it would hit the servos, so.
Mm-hmm. How much am I taking?
Sorry, Vinny. Like, probably a million. It's only 10, Vinny. It could be worse.
I'm laughing because he didn't say my name in there.
Okay, first strike damage.
You take 5, okay. And then...
discard a card?
You discard a card, I untap all of my lands. Okay. I return a creature from my graveyard to my hand. I gain 3 life. And then Mask of Memory triggers, and I draw 2 cards, and then discard a card.
And then it happens again.
Oh, yeah, let's look at Wes's board state. This is unbelievable.
It's only like turn 6, really.
Second main phase.
Uh-huh.
Casts Angelic Purge.
Oh, no.
The Nevin Thrall's Disc, sacrificing my Germ Token.
We're not in blue, dude. All
right, game over.
Whew. Thank God I got rid of that Nev's Disc. Now I'm back in command and control of the board.
That really sucked, because that sort of blew my entire plan out of the water. In response, so at that point, I'm like, all right, well, the only way that we're gonna get back from this is if Josh maybe draws his Bane of Progress to delete Wes's board, because Wes is looking super intimidating right now.
Let's Magus up the wheel.
Sure.
All right.
Whoa, hang on.
Because of Vidalcan Orrery, I can play out as many cards as possible right then.
And that's when everything just starts to go downhill for everyone else.
I'm going to tap 5 and Paradox Engine.
Okay. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, that's very good, it seems.
And I'm gonna tap 5 and Verdurous Gearhulk.
Ooh, that guy's so good in that deck.
Which actually puts counters on the servo tokens, which means they can now tap for mana.
Paradox Engine will untap everything.
Mm.
I'll tap these 4, cast Spike Weaver.
Mm-hmm.
Which will untap these guys.
Mm.
Spike Weaver will get its counters. Trigger.
Yep.
Animation module. Make a servo. Tap 3. Reclamation Sage.
I'll blow up Wes's Sword of Feast and Famine. Then they'll all untap.
Oh my gosh.
Then I'll tap them all again. Floating 2 and Sylvan Library.
Woo!
And everything untaps.
So he starts to basically go through his entire hand and play stuff out, untap all his mana dorks, and tap them all again.
And then I will animation module to put a counter here, tap that to make another servo.
I can't even keep track of everything he's doing, but I thought I'd be in a really commanding position when Nev's disc had left the board. But actually, Josh was starting to look pretty scary.
And at that point, I realized Josh has just shot himself so far ahead,
and he's about to draw a fresh new 7 cards. That's not good.
And so, now, Magus of the Wheel results.
So everyone discard their hand and then draw 7 brand new cards.
So I'm feeling really good, and I just kind of have to hold my breath through Vinny's turn, because if Vinny has a board wipe at that point, I'm basically back to the Stone Age.
Okay, may I continue with my turn?
Yep.
Cool, I'm gonna play Dark Steel Plate.
Oh, that is a problem.
And draw a card off Sram.
And I'm done.
Whatever, he's probably got a board wipe in there.
Listen.
Dude, just let me have one battle it out with homie over there.
So what you're saying is I should not board wipe, is what you're saying.
I'm absolutely 100% going after Wes. Like, this has to happen.
Fine, Josh. I'm gonna see what happens.
See what happens, Larry?
This may be the worst decision of the game.
No. Vidal can orb.
Oh, all right.
Now I can hold onto a board wipe and play it whenever I need to. Like, if Josh is gonna swing at other people and kill other people, I'm okay with that. I don't need to do anything. But if he starts attacking me, well, yeah, then I gotta kill his creatures.
I like this. This is good.
Okay?
All right.
Pass!
So I untap. I have a ton of creatures. They all have +1/+1 counters on them.
So the way Paradox Engine works, I'm gonna tap 4, floating 2.
Uh-huh.
Play Panharmonicon. Uh-huh. So I'm floating 2.
Okay.
Untap everything.
So Josh is starting to go off and get really, really scary.
Tap 6, use 1 on the floating, so I'm floating 1. Okay. Play Zendikar Resurgent. Tap everything.
Oh.
So he's essentially able to tap everything, float extra mana, play a creature, draw a card, untap everything, and with the extra mana floating, use his module to make a servo or to put a +1/+1 counter on something. When everything untaps, he has extra mana, plays another card.
I can do that again. I can do that again.
I'll play Ridge Scale Tusker.
And then because of Panharmonicon, I'll put 2 +1/+1 counters on everything and then draw a card for Zendikar Resurgent. And then I'll play Regal Force. And again, because of Panharmonicon, it'll trigger twice. So I'll draw 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 14 cards.
And I misstepped here because I got 2 threatening.
Okay. Hold. And that's where I'm like, oh, no. If he draws more cards, he could draw into even more win conditions. Nope, I have to stop this.
Life's finale.
And so he wipes away my board, but the good side is, in response to Vinny's board wipe, I'm able to float just a ton of mana. So I'm able to tap my guys, cradle them, I'll tap all my guys. And so, yeah, all my board gets blown up, but I still have like 27 mana or 28 mana in my mana pool.
Resolves, all right. All creatures gone.
And Vinny wipes the entire board, and it doesn't actually matter.
So I have 28 mana floating. Now I have 26 mana floating. I use 2 on Secure Tribe Elder. Draw because of Zendikar Resurgent. Play Tireless Tracker. Have 23 mana now floating. Draw. Play Metallic Mimic. Naming Elf. Have 21 mana floating. Play Rishkar. Trigger. Animation Module. I make 2 servos.
Pay 3 mana, tap the Animation Module, put a counter. Pay 1 mana, make a servo. Then Endless One.
Make a servo. Nissa. And then Nissa will put a 1/1 on everything. Make a servo.
Josh just keeps playing more stuff out of his hand. He rebuilds his board almost immediately.
He board wiped in the middle of my turn, and I'm like, whatever, I still have 1,000,000 creatures. The problem was they didn't have haste. So here I am, I'm gonna have to hold my breath again
and pass turn, because that is all I can do.
That is all that he can do.
So by the end of his turn, it was basically I did nothing.
I will play Duretti, Scrap Savant.
Cool.
And then I will -2 him to sacrifice the Ronin War Club to bring out Silent Arbiter.
Oh,
sick.
Jimmy's turn here was really, really huge for making us feel like we had a chance to beat Josh, because Silent Arbiter prevents him from just swinging out with all of his creatures. So it doesn't matter how many creatures I have. I could have 1,000. Only 1 can attack.
So maybe we have a chance.
And then I'll pass turn.
Wow.
Okay, I'm gonna tap a Plains, play a Thraven Inspector.
Yay!
Put a clue out.
Yay.
He is going to crew Smuggler's Copter and cracking at you, Josh, for 3.
Take 3.
Draw a card and discard. Play an Oriok Edgerite. Then I'll tap 2, equip Dark Steel Plate onto it. And then I'll also equip Mask of Memory.
So on just a Dark Steel Plate equipped to one of my creatures, I feel like I can just hold the fort for at least a few turns while we figure out a better plan.
And then I am done. Go ahead.
Draw a card.
So I have a Dockle Ori out, so I can hold onto my cards in my hand, so I pass.
Go ahead.
Tap 9, guys. Play Soul New Phyrexia, so I'm putting 3.
Okay.
So basically, they need 3 board wipes to be able to get rid of my stuff, or they need the type of board wipes that don't care if your stuff's indestructible.
Okay, I'll play Worldbreaker, and when it enters, I'll exile the Silent Arbiter.
And now the shields are down. The rebels can storm Endor and take out the Death Star.
Play Sword of Fire and Ice. Equip Sword of Fire and Ice onto Endless One. Okay, so this is Vinny, this is Jimmy.
Okay, I take 32.
All right, before blocks, right? Flash out, get a Lotus, tap the rest of my mana, cast Harvesters.
Yep.
And I wasn't really thinking. Vinny had Vidalcan Orrery, and he just flashes in a creature, and he blocks my guy. So now I've just given Vinny a free turn. I could have just swung everything at him. Jimmy doesn't die. I didn't have enough to kill him. So I gave them another turn with which to find some kind of an answer.
Pass turn.
Tap five and play Siege Gang Commander. You get three goblins. And then I'll play Goblin Bombardment. So at the very least, I can do four damage to Josh's face. I pass the turn to Wes, and it's all up to Wes now.
Okay, Josh, what are you at?
I am at 25 life.
Pure Steel Paladin.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Draw two cards per
turn. Yeah, draw two cards
per equipment.
Wait.
It's only one because Sram's not out.
Sram's not out.
If I could just get rid of Worldbreaker, that's the issue. Is there any way we can get rid of that thing? Not really.
I can't touch it. It's got protection from red.
I can. I could do four damage to Josh at instant speed. With Goblin Bombardment. So if anyone can do 21 damage to Josh.
Well, I'm like close, that's why. Actually.
Wes then starts going into the tank.
Oh,
what's he got?
I think I kill you.
What?
What?
And he starts like doing that thing where people are like, you know, he's like pointing at his cards.
Two, three.
And you can see the numbers are like swirling around his head.
Seven.
All the math is going on.
I think I have it. Okay, cool.
Oh, crap. Like, I don't know. I guess I'm dead here.
Walking through it. Step one, equip Paradise Mantle to Thraven Inspector for free off of Pure Steel Paladin.
Yeah, it allows him to tap for mana.
Tap this for one. Make Blinkmoth Nexus into a artifact creature. Equip Leonin Bola to Blinkmoth Nexus. I'll put Paradise Mantle onto Oriok Edrite.
He's equipping everything for free onto one of his creatures. He's using one of his things to make all of his creatures tap for mana and then switching the equipment to another person.
Play Inquisitor's Flail, Darksteel Axe, Mizawa's Jita. Draw. Tap Pure Steel Paladin, activate Smuggler's Copter.
I rearrange all my stuff as best I can. I put all of my equipment on my Smuggler's Copter.
Equip everything to it.
He slides like 17,000 equipment onto a Smuggler's Copter.
This is my Smuggler's Copter. Seems good.
How many equipments do you have on there right now?
Four, 10.
What is it right now?
It is a 10-13 that deals double damage when it hits, and it has a Mizar's Jita on it.
So Wes swings in at Josh,
and the Smuggler's Copter is just big enough that it'll knock me down to like two or three life, and then Jimmy will be able to Goblin Bombardment, sack his guys, and finish me off for the last few points of damage.
Attacking you, and tap. Remove Leonin Bola, tap down Worldbreaker.
And he finally has this thing that can tap a creature down, and Worldbreaker is the only creature on Josh's board that can block a flyer.
Okay, so Worldbreaker gets tapped, and then I will play.
Fortunately, I have Paradox Engine out, so all I have to do is cast a spell, and that will untap the Worldbreaker.
Concordant Crossroads.
Sure, untap.
To untap everything.
Which I do, and then I block, and the Smuggler's Copter eats my Worldbreaker, but it doesn't matter, I live, I survive through that turn.
Okay, Vinny, can you do 21 damage to Josh?
No. Pass.
And on this turn, because the card that I played to untap the Worldbreaker was Concordant Crossroads, everything I play is gonna have haste.
Armorcraft Judge.
Draw.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 9, 10. Panharmonic Zendikar Card Resurgent. Draw 20.
20, 21. Oh my gosh.
Josh starts going off. He starts playing things, untapping everything.
Woodfall Primus. Terastodon. Duplicant.
So this turn, I just am able to play basically every creature in my deck.
Play Great Oak Guardian, so Great Oak Guardian will trigger twice. Everything is +4/+4.
And then, rah, just, and attack! We didn't do the math, but I'm pretty sure everyone died.
It was a fun game. I think the main thing I needed was just more ramp and the ability to get to my bigger stuff faster.
I relied too heavily on having mana rocks and having mana ramp in the very beginning in order to cast the bigger creatures. So I think I need to cut out the bigger creatures a little bit and have a little bit more early game stuff.
Really, I think the big takeaway was Wes's deck and how sweet it was.
My deck's sweet. I like it a lot. It's a lot of fun to play, but it runs into a lot of the same pitfalls that all Voltron decks run into. It kind of covers up for the card advantage thing, but the way that Commander games roll out, Voltron deck is kind of lucky if they just kind of latch onto one person and kill them off, and then eventually everyone else kind of outscales them as they build up their mana base and play more powerful things.
We took out the Death Star!
Hold up. You were the Death Star.
No, this is the victors write the history.
All right, you made it to the end of the episode, so it's giveaway time!
Woohoo!
We have all this awesome stuff. You may have noticed during the episode, Ultra Pro was great. They sponsored this video, and they gave us, as a result, a whole ton of product, which you're going to be the direct beneficiary of.
Ooh, very lucky. So we have a ton of awesome stuff in front of us. We've got these deck boxes from Kanner 2016. This one has Saskia on it.
Sriracha sleeves. Yeah, we got tons of Sriracha sleeves.
Pretty cool. We have these awesome metal dice.
Oh, man,
well,
those are so sweet. They're like the really hard, heavy metal dice, and they come in this magnetic metal case. We're going to give them away, but I wish I had them.
Yeah.
The really big thing is that Ultra Pro's got these new sleeves. They're called Eclipse sleeves. They're their sort of high-end sleeves, and they have a really great shuffle feel. I was very impressed with them.
Yeah. They fit double sleeve cards as well. They come in a bunch of different colors, and they're matte. You can't see through them on the back. A lot of the white sleeves I have, unfortunately, have the problem you're able to see through them.
That's a really good point. The white and the yellow, I think in most other sleeves, you'd be able to see the card through the back, but you can't on these. So it's great, and they're tournament legal that way.
Yep.
We got this awesome case.
Deluxe gaming case.
A whole bunch of other stuff that can't fit on screen. So what you can do is you can enter to win some of this stuff. Oh, we should also say that Jimmy and I are both going to sign
the playmats we used.
The playmats we used, and send those out as prizes as well. So you can get a signed, I'll even put "How's it?" on mine. Rishkar can be yelling, "How's it?"
So the way you guys can enter the contest is very simple. First, you need to be following us on Twitter, @CommandCast. And then after this episode is released, simply tweet out anything using the hashtag #GameNights. And that's Knights with a K in front of it. Now, of course, it'd be awesome if it was episode related, but that's how we're going to keep track of the entries. So, again, make sure you're following @CommandCast on Twitter and tweet out something using the hashtag #GameNights. It could be the link to the episode. It could be your thoughts on a combo. Anything you want.
Yep, it's as easy as that. We're going to be giving the prizes away and selecting the winners 1 week from the release of this show. So you have 1 week. If you're not on Twitter, join Twitter. Just enter the contest. You can delete your Twitter after you win all this cool stuff. Or you can, you know, stay on Twitter and talk to us all the time. That's cool, too.
Yeah, direct access. And, of course, that also means direct access to hopefully some prizes coming your way. So, thank you guys for watching. Hope you can win some of this free, awesome stuff. And we'll see you on Twitter.
How's it?
Want to learn more about the Rishkar and Sram decks? Check out the latest episode of The Command Zone, where we go in-depth on both of these awesome commanders.
Drawing a card for every card you play is just awesome.
Just awesome. Pure Steel Paladin, obviously a huge overperform of the fact that you can equip at zero.
Well, it's just because it's SRAM number two.
Let me just check the notes in my Sriracha notebook.
You're the most redundant person today.
Oh, man, I wish I had my sleeves over. I'm so proud of them. Okay.